Billboard Radio China, bringing the world to China and China to the world.
This is Vlatka for Billboard Radio China on another edition of 10 Questions. And I'm talking today to Andy, Ryan, Joel and Adam, who are an English pop rock band named Lawson. The band's debut album, Chapman Square, was released 2012 and reached number 3 on the UK album charts. And they released their second album this year called Perspective with the hit single Roads. To date, the band has achieved an impressive 7 UK top 20 hit singles. They sold out gigs worldwide, shared a stage with the likes of Bruce Springsteen and most recently Robbie Williams. I caught up with them on their way to Australia as they stopped over in Hong Kong to do a showcase at the Apple store in the city. Let's hear more on today's episode of 10 Questions.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
10 questions.
This is Vlatka for Billboard Radio China and 10 questions with Lawson. So, hey guys, welcome to Hong Kong, first of all. How are you doing and what's your first impression of the city? Did anything weird happen to you, you know, while you landed in this last few days?
Nothing really weird, but we've had an amazing time in Hong Kong so far. We actually have to leave today, which is really upsetting. We've only been for 2 days.
Which we did get to see the National Day, which was great, all the fireworks and everything. We tried all the local street food and stuff like that. That, which was great.
You played yesterday at the Apple store. How was that and what did you do so far in the city?
Basically, we did the show yesterday, which was amazing. So many people came out and, you know, were singing everywhere, which was incredible for us. You know, being from the UK, you don't expect that. So we did that, and then we also went to the temple and, you know, had our fortunes read, which was great.
Yesterday was Thursday, and I don't know if you know that or if the guys took you out, but Thursdays is usually a ladies' night in Hong Kong. Okay. So did you go and check out Lan Kwai Fong, which is sort of the party area?
Oh, well, we never got told that.
You've only just told us.
We've only just found out about this.
Are men allowed to venture out to ladies' night?
Yeah, of course. That's why it's called. You know, okay, so Wednesday night, it's also ladies' night. And in one part of the city. And Thursdays.
Yeah. Because in the UK, if men found out there was a ladies' night on Thursday, then there would be about 200% more men out on that night than there would be women.
That is also the case over here. Okay. So you get free drinks as a lady, right? Anywhere you go in this area, you get a free drink or like really cheap and stuff.
Wow.
Exactly. And did you check out the night scene at all in Hong Kong?
We did, yeah. When we first arrived, we had an incredible meal overlooking the whole of the skyline, which is brilliant. We went on this rooftop bar, had a look over the city, had a few drinks. Yeah, I got talking to some locals. Brilliant. You know, we love meeting new people. Though it's and Hong Kong, obviously, such a great place, and seems like a very vibrant nightlife as well. You know, it seems to be a lot of people love partying.
We want to go for a night out in Central. We've heard it's a good laugh. What is it, LKF? Is that what
yeah,
you call
LKF,
it?
Yeah.
So we want to do LKF. I am a local now.
Straight into the pipeline.
See, life is like commission, you only get what you earn, but you will get in attention.
As I said, you played there yesterday, but you also released a new album as well. And it's been a while since you released this album. What took you so long and what were you doing in the time when you were not doing anything?
We were writing, to be honest. Yeah, we released our first album, Chapman Square, in the UK and some places and some parts of Asia and, you know, Europe. And then we took some time out to write. You know, we spent like a year in Nashville in America just writing songs, writing, just making sure that the new material was perfect. And, you know, the new album we've released is actually a hybrid album of some new songs and some old songs, because we haven't actually released anything in Hong Kong, so we're very excited to do that. And then basically we're going to then release probably the full album of new material next year, so it means we can return next year and do, you know, a big show here. But yeah, we like to take our time over the writing process and don't rush anything. You know, the songs need to be top quality, you know what I mean, and we need to make sure that they're perfect before we release it. So that's pretty much what we've been doing.
And you mentioned Nashville. I mean, I know it's a very musical city, but it's very also country. From all the places, why Nashville?
The studio we were recording in, really, our producer John Fields suggested it to us, and he just said it was the best studio he'd ever worked in. The guy that owns it's a huge Beatles fan, so there's like, you can record a Beatles album, they have all the same mics, all the same instruments, everything. It's just a really like inspirational place, and we definitely had to up our game. Like, you go out on a night out and every bar had a band in that was like the world's greatest session musicians, like whether they're playing for Miley Cyrus or Carrie Underwood or whoever, they're in that city playing in this tiny little bar. Like,
like, and then the next day they'll be off to some stadium somewhere else. So it's a wicked place, and we were massively inspired by the music there and the people and by the food as well. There's some great barbecue food.
You also sold out, you know, gigs worldwide pretty much, also in UK, in US. Why do you think that is, and especially in US, you know, an English band?
I think a lot of people gravitate towards our music because it's real. You know, it's real life situations based on real life experiences. And I think also a lot of people really appreciate the musicianship in the band. You know, we are basically just four musos, you know, who started at music college and basically perfected our craft, you know, whether it be me as a songwriter and as a singer, you know, Joel as a guitarist, Adam as a drummer, Ryan as a bass player, you know. So I think a lot of people appreciate that. And I think it's also quite difficult to find a really good live band these days, you know. I think the market's quite saturated with like boy bands and stuff like that, which is great if you're into that sort of thing. But I just think a lot of people appreciate a really good band, you know.
Obviously in UK, it's a quite competitive market. And what made a difference, do you think, that you sort of made it, other than other bands who are also doing it, but you know, not as successful as you are?
A lot of touring before we even got signed, and we were kind of building up a fan base that way. So we had 2.5-3 years, we just went up and down the UK in a van, playing to 10 people one night, 20 people the next night, and we'd keep going back to these cities and growing the fan base each time. So then by the time we got signed, really had a loyal fan base on board, and I think that made a huge difference.
The track Roads explores addiction, and Andy got it from a line in a TV show where the main character said, "All roads lead back to you." And it got him thinking about love addiction and a girl he couldn't get away from. So my question is, did you get away from that girl? And what advice do you have for people that are suffering love addiction?
I actually didn't get away from her, no. I'm with her now. So all roads led back to her. And
the song's true.
Yeah, I think they will always continue to lead back to her, because I think I was just in love with this girl, so I just couldn't go anywhere. But it was actually from a Californication. I don't know whether it's very big out here or whatever, but if it isn't, you should check it out. It's a really, really good TV series with David Duchovny, who's in X-Files. I would say, you know, in this sort of situation with love and relationships and stuff, you just gotta follow your heart. You know, if it feels right, go with it, you know what I mean? Like, and that's what happened with me. I mean, I tried to explore some other options, and no matter what I did, I always ended up back at square one. So it sort of seemed like a really good topic to write about as well, a good song. And you know, we just mix that with some haze and some foot stomps and some claps, and you know, then you've got a hit song.
Now you're on your way to Australia, and you're going to be supporting Robbie Williams. How did that actually happen, and who sort of organised that?
It was actually you, Andy, wasn't it? I'm sure you saw the tour, because we've gigged with Robbie before. We've had dinner with him a couple of times, and like, he's a really, really nice guy, and we've obviously all grown up admiring him and his work. And you saw the tour, Andy, didn't you? And reached out to Guy Chambers, who you've written with before, who writes with Robbie
and plays keys in his band as well now.
Yeah, and we basically just said, you know, Guy, could you ask Robbie if it, cause obviously, you know, as the band, and you know, if he likes us and stuff, could you ask him if he wants us to support him, because we'd love the opportunity.
And Guy's a great guy, isn't he?
He's a great guy, yeah.
And he passed on the message, and Robbie said, yeah, definitely, let's get these boys on the tour. So kind of all gone from there, and now here we are on our way to us to play with them.
Did you ever think this is going to happen? You know, when you started music, did you ever think like, wow, I'm going to be in Hong Kong, you know, talking to Billboard and going to Australia on this tour, and I don't know.
Never. If you had told me that 5 years ago, I'd have laughed in your face. So it's incredible. And I mean, 5 years ago, we were still working away, trying to get somewhere. We were playing in bars. I used to work in a bar where I used to get as I think we had a gig in there every other Friday, and that was like our gig. And if you'd have told me this 5 years ago, I'd not believed you.
Used to get paid with alcohol.
Yeah,
they said, come and do a gig. Come and do a gig.
Very well paid. Yeah.
Give you free drinks. So we were like, okay, that's good.
Looking back at it, would you change anything that you've done?
I mean, you know, everyone makes mistakes, don't they? I mean,
I think we would look back and say,
oh, maybe we should have released that song, or what, imagine if we would have released that song. But I think that, you know, for me, all things happen for a reason, you know
all
what I mean?
All roads have led us
to this where we are today, you know? So I think...
To Billboard.
Yeah.
All roads lead to Billboard.
I don't think we would have changed anything. I think, you know, our journey is our journey. That's what makes us who we are. That's Lawson. And hopefully what we need to do now is just to build on that, keep building on it, and, you know, keep writing good songs. I think that's the most important thing in music. I think you can be as good as you want to be at anything, but if your songs don't talk to people, you know, you won't have a long career. So I really think, you know, that's the most important thing, just making sure your songs are amazing, basically, and people relate to them and people want to tell their friends, have you heard this song by this band? Check it out. That's the most important thing. So as long as we continue to write good songs, I think we'll have a long career.
And you are writing most of the stuff, or?
Yeah, I write it all and, you know, show it to the guys, and then we work on it as a group and, you know, improve it. And yeah, and, you know, it's difficult because, you know, there's a lot of opinions, you know, and everyone likes different types of music, but I always think a good lyric and a good melody will always shine through, you know what I mean? So we're lucky enough that we all like the same styles of music, you know.
It's the great thing about the kind of songs Andy writes as well. Andy can write a song where you can, an incredible song no matter how you play it. So we can have a full acoustic version with like pedal steel guitar and or just keyboards, or we can have a really rocked up version of the same song, or a country version of that song, or a dance version of that song. Just how Andy writes songs, like melodically and, you know, the lyric, it just leaves you open to so much like musicality. So
are you inspired by life, or what inspires you when you write?
Relationships, yeah, life, TV programs, you know what I mean? Like, literally, is that anything? You can watch a TV program and be like, oh, that was interesting what he just said, you know, just reading stuff online, you know, reading stories, Twitter, Instagram, anything, you know what I mean? You can find inspiration from anything.
Your writing process, like, you know, I mean, you can see something, like, help me, because I'm trying to write, but I don't think I'm very good. So I don't know, is there some secret?
I think at the moment for me, probably lyrics first, find a really cool concept or a title, and then just basically try and sing a cool melody that fits in with the lyric. You know, that's a lot of, like, Roads, for instance, All Roads Lead to You was wrote on my phone like 2 years ago, you know, and then just try and then figure out a cool melody to go with that tagline, you know. And then, but that's one way of doing it. Sometimes, you know, like we know Ryan Tedder from One Republic, and he told us that, you know, he'd be driving along in his car and a melody would just pop into his head and he'd just be like humming it, and then he'd just take out his iPhone and be like sing it in, and then put a beat underneath it, and then, you know, stuff like that. So I think it's anything really, that anything, just that moment in time can sort of, you think of a cool melody, just record it into your phone, or a cool lyric, write it down into your phone or something.
Can you guys name me three musicians that influence, you know, every one of you?
John Mayer is definitely up there for us, especially Joel's a guitarist, but his albums and his music have really inspired us, so that's probably number one. I think kind of live performance wise, especially for me, Robbie Williams, like watching live in Nebworth back when I was probably, what, 12, 13, when that kind of came out, watching that DVD and watching the kind of showmanship and how incredible the band could be and the show you could put on, and the fact that you could do shows that big to, I think it was 130,000 people a night or something like that. It was crazy. And to see how big things could get and how epic you can make shows just inspired me. I was like, I need to be drumming on stage. And so that definitely inspired me, which makes kind of the upcoming month so much more special as well.
Who else
would
you say?
Maybe a band like Coldplay, something like that, you know, just, you know, one singer, one guitarist, bass, drums, that's it, you know what I mean? Just
the Beatles.
Touring the world, the Beatles, obviously. So many great bands have came from the UK, haven't they? You know, in Ireland as well, U2, fantastic band, Script. I definitely think we're inspired by bands, and, you know, because you can watch them and be like, oh, we could do that. But also John Mayer as a guitarist, Joel, Dave Grohl as a drummer and as a frontman. So yeah, I think just basically really great musicians, songwriters and tight bands.
How much are you actually hands-on? How much are you involved with the whole process?
We're really fussy about every single detail. So, I mean, only this morning I was looking at my emails, we're getting through all kinds of different artworks for like tour posters or album artworks or singles or whatever it may be, even down to, you know, what photo we use on like flyers or like the tiniest little things. So yeah, we're really hands on with everything.
I just think because we've always done it, you know, when we first started out, there was only us doing it. It was only us sort of promoting the band and trying to get us bigger and trying to get people to hear us. So I think you never kind of lose that if you've done it that way. You know, you always want to be involved because it's been our baby for, you know, six and a half years. But I'm wanting you back, girl. Now I'm standing in the dark, dark, oh, dark, dark, oh, dark, dark. She's someone else's angel. She's someone else's angel.
What's what's life like nowadays for a pop rock band travelling and doing?
It's not tough, like that part of it, the travelling and whatever, we love that. I think it's tough for the music to break through. I mean,
there's just so much dance music, which is, you know, it's great. It's great music. We all love it. It's, you know, really, it's good. And we even take, you know, inspiration from some of that music. But it's very hard for a live band to be in the charts and to be competing with these kind of DJs. And,
yeah, true.
It's such a dance generation at the moment when people are going on a night out. Whereas when we were growing up and going on a night out, you listen to Fallout Boy, you listen to
especially with the new streaming, the streaming laws across the world. Obviously, now the music industry is developing into having to take in streaming into account. That massively affects things like your chart position and stuff, because obviously dance music's going to be much more streamed than a band, as Adam
said.
It's
less based on your fan base now. Like, a lot of times your fan base will go out and buy the song, whereas now people just listen to music, you know, so a lot of people are listening to dance music, and that then makes those artists go higher in the charts, you know. So, but you know, we just keep doing our thing. And as long as we can keep playing live shows to sell out audiences, I think that for us is the most important thing. So.
And after this tour, you're going to Australia, and after that, what's going on?
Going to UK to do a tour over there, so we're really excited about that. And then somewhere else over Christmas that's not yet announced, but we're looking forward to it. It's going to be good. Seeing the world, as well as seeing home, which is nice. So, yeah.
You know, you're here, but you've never actually performed live here or in China. Are you thinking about maybe coming back to Hong Kong and the mainland?
Absolutely, yeah. We always want to come back here. You know, it's our favourite place in the world, to be honest, Asia. It's really, you know, incredible people, incredible, you know, places, you know, so it's unbelievable.
The shows, the fans are incredible.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, the food. Food's great.
So we'll definitely be back, hopefully next year.
Mainland China would be really cool to see. It'd be great to do a gig there as well.
Can you actually walk around in UK without being recognised?
Depends, really. When all four of us together, we usually get recognised because, you know, we look like a band. But it depends, really. When you're by yourself, sometimes, not really, sometimes you will. It all depends on whether someone's a Lawson fan or not, you know.
It's always really annoying when I get recognised. It's always the most annoying. Like, I can go out, say I'm going out on like a night out or whatever, you know, look, I've really made an effort, no one will even notice, and then I'll go out the next morning hungover in like my pants, like trying to just get some milk or something, and everyone will ask for a picture. Yeah, it's not that bad unless we're together, as you say. But
does that get really old, you know?
It's always great to meet. If people like the music, then we want to meet them, because nothing feels better than someone coming up and saying, oh, I love this song means this to me, this song means that to me, or I've seen you guys live 5 times and stuff like that, because that's why we do it. We want people to come and see us live. We want the music to kind of speak to people and to relate to it. And if you can relate to a piece of music enough or an album enough to go and see that band live, then that's huge. They're giving up their night, they're giving up money to come and see this band live. So that's so cool for us, and for people to kind of come up to us and tell us about their experiences for that is awesome. So never gets old.
Do you still get excited about seeing a band yourself, or, you know, an artist or something?
Definitely, yeah.
All the time. Anytime, you know, we're always keeping our ear to the ground, see who's playing in our local cities and what it's all about. You know, we've all grown up going and seeing bands, and we always, you know, exchange stories about different people we've seen. Like, maybe Adam's seen a band that I haven't, and, you know, and then we'll go see them together and he'll be like, look how good they are. And Fallout Boy, for example,
festivals is good for that as well.
Yeah.
Because you get to watch your favourite bands and perform. No, it's best of both.
That's one thing I struggle with when I do go and watch a band. Like, we all went to see Maroon 5 a few months ago, and it kills me to watch a band and know that I'm not performing that night or that day. Like, it's I can't watch a band and not want to get up on stage. It's really, really tough. But
like that show, for instance, the Maroon 5 show, was incredible. And we went and saw it in London, and we happened to be in Manchester when they were in Manchester at the same time. We went twice because it was just a really inspiring show, because we can take so much from it, because kind of the way they play the songs and kind of rock it up live was awesome. The production, we get excited by it all, so yeah, that was awesome.
Can you give an advice to, you know, maybe kids here in Hong Kong who are trying out pop music, rock music, and they're in a band? What are some of the things that should definitely do as a band or be good at?
Just practice, just keep going, get in a rehearsal room, grab your instruments, play as much as you can, you know.
Social media.
Yeah. Social media is great, obviously, yeah, like you're saying, you know, anything like Instagram or anything like that that you can get involved in and just get people to hear your music. Apple Music, you know, promote that. Let's get people just listening to music. So
put your stuff on YouTube, cover some, you know, songs.
Cover some Lawson songs.
That'd be great. You met MySpace, didn't you?
Yeah. But we met MySpace and then we got signed through having songs on YouTube. So, you know, you never know who's going to see it, you know. For instance, you know, you might cover a Lawson song. One of us might be looking online. Oh, I like that guy. Oh, why don't you come and support us on tour? You know, could open doors.
Great. Well, thank you so much, guys. This is Vlatka with Lawson for Billboard Radio China. 10 questions with
We hope you enjoyed this archive from Billboard Radio China. To see and hear more great content, visit www.billboardradiochina.com.